Hello and welcome to another episode of Let's Talk, exploring the issues affecting all of our lives. I'm your host, Austin Harris. In July, the Cayman Islands were represented by 21 athletes participating in the 2022 Commonwealth Games, which were held in Birmingham, England. Team Cayman competed in six sports, and on today's two-part episode, we take a look back at three of those sports, which recorded a number of personal bests, at least three finals appearances, and a gold medal for the Cayman Islands. It is my pleasure to welcome to this episode of Let's Talk Sports, we have chef de mission, Janet Sersing, and gold winner in squash, athlete Julian Jervis. Welcome to both of you, and thank you for being our guest.
Oh, thank you so much for having us.
Absolute pleasure to have you in studios. Congratulations on what has to be defined as a fantastic showing at the Commonwealth Games 2022.
Oh yeah, man, thank you so much. It's still surreal. So it's awesome to be getting the recognition for it. It feels as though like all of the work that we've done over the last 3 years without having competition has come through fruition, and it's all paid off, and it just feels really good to have love and celebration back home for it.
Fantastic. Well, hopefully today we'll, you know, have an opportunity to take a walk down memory lane and ask you to recount some of those memories and some of those experiences for the benefit of our listening audience.
For sure.
We have sort of a tradition here on Let's Talk. Before we get down to the nitty gritty of the conversation, we want to get to know our guests a little bit. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about yourselves, your background, perhaps specific to the Commonwealth Games, what brought you to Team Cayman. We'll begin with you, Miss Janet.
Well, thank you. On a professional level, I am the CFO and vice president of operations of an insurance company. But my passion is really about sports. And I started my journey in sports from a tender age of 8, playing on the national team for netball. And then I picked up badminton and then transitioned to squash. And, you know, being in sports for such a young age, I gained from it, and it taught me about leadership and team play. And that then transitioned into, as I got older, I thought, well, I need to give back to the sport and pass on some of that. And therefore, I volunteer on, you know, various sporting organization boards, and I provide the guidance and the leadership to those boys.
Excellent. Thank you so very much for that, Janet. Julian, likewise, a little bit about the man, the legend, Julian Jervis.
Doesn't feel like I deserve that, but I'll definitely take it today. Okay. And just before I start, I just wanted to big up Janet further on what she said in terms of like all the volunteer work that she does and just all of the work that she does in general for squash and for every sport in Cayman. Like, this woman is a real legend. Like, we wouldn't be able to get to do any of the things that we do without her. So, yeah, just proper big up on the end of what she just said. But I've been playing squash from the age, competitively around the age of 11, before that, since I was walking. So I played competitively for the Cayman national team from the age of 11. I made it to the final of my first Caribbean junior championships after only playing for a year. So I knew within that first year that I had potential to grow in the sport. And from then, I started to take it quite seriously. I started taking on coaching and as part of the national team. And as a junior, majority of my competitive career was based around Caribbean tournaments. I didn't really do too much outside of the Caribbean. But I was able to, through my success in the Caribbean, I was able to win 3 junior national titles. And that was enough to get me recruited to a really high-level squash university, St. Lawrence University, where I attended for 2 years. Okay. Before transferring over to George Washington University, again, another high-level squash team. And I was able to win, in my last 2 years, historic championships for them as well, actually. We won national championships twice in my last 2 years, which was really nice to end off on that note. Since then, I've been back in Cayman. After about a year in Cayman, I took up the role, and I'm now the head pro and squash coach of the South Sound Squash Club.
Excellent. Wow. And you're just 24, is that correct?
I actually just turned 25 yesterday.
Oh, happy belated birthday.
Thank you. Thank
happy
you.
Happy belated birthday.
Yeah.
Well, again, a real pleasure to have you both as our guests in studios. Look forward to hearing about your experiences at the 2022 Commonwealth Games. Janet, back to you. Perhaps one of the well, one of the questions on my mind, and I suspect the question on a lot of people's mind, when we talk about your position, your title, Chef de Mission, you don't cook meals for the team. Maybe you can explain to the audience.
Subtle thing, don't let mom into the kitchen.
what does that role mean in terms of the athletics?
Chef de Mission is a French translation, basically head of mission. So in the context of sports, it's head of delegation for international events. So as a chef de mission, you know, my responsibility basically is to ensure the well-being of the entire team. You know, we have the coaches and they deal with more the technical aspect, but as a chef, it's all about the logistic and ensuring that the players and the athletes have everything at their disposal for optimum performance. So I take that headache away from them as the chef de mission, and you know, whether it's the transportation, the venue, you know, health and safety, everything, you know, that's the part that that I deal with as a chef and all the other chefs. So
yeah. All right, well, for those of us who obviously watch the opening ceremonies here at home, and of course there's many different heats and sports events that we could that were televised, certainly the athletes looked to, you know, composed and focused and happy, and they were all in, you know, great Cayman colors. I would say congratulations. I think you definitely accomplished that mission.
Yeah, well, thank you. And I think, too, one other thing, you know, we should point out as it relates to an international team, just to educate the general public, is I think there was a blogger that says, why is it that, you know, you have 14 officials and 21 athletes? Mm-hmm. And I think what we have to understand is that, you know, for a team, you know, the different components
sure.
to it. You know, you travel with medical, you travel with a physio, and you know, with a team too, for each sport you have a coach,
right?
And sometimes, depending on the size, a team manager. So you know, while a coach is dealing with the field of play, the technical manager would be in a management meeting, mm-hmm. dealing with more the logistic around the sport,
sure.
etc. So therefore, you know, we have six sports, so therefore you will require the officials to do, you know, the different aspect of it. So that is the reason why a team comprised of so many, you know, other personnel other than just the athletes, because we have to ensure that everything is provided for optimum performance for athletes.
Absolutely, and certainly to your point, you're competing in an international event. You're not at home, so you want to bring everybody and everything that you are going to need in order to assist those athletes.
Exactly.
Another question that sometimes is often asked is, what's the difference between the Commonwealth Games and, say, the Olympics?
Well, the Olympics, you're looking at all countries.
Right.
Right? But the Commonwealth is dealing with all the Commonwealth countries. So you wouldn't have in the Commonwealth, like, the USA.
Right, right.
And, you know, some of the other Republic countries.
Gotcha.
So, yeah.
All right. But certainly, from a regional standpoint, this is the Commonwealth's Olympic Games, if you will call it as such.
Exactly. And especially, like, for the sports of squash. Squash is not in the Olympics, so the Commonwealth is the Olympics and the pinnacle of all tournaments for squash and for other sports that are not in the Olympics.
Excellent. Thank you for that. Back to you, Julian, on the subject of squash. 2022 in Birmingham, England, wasn't your first Commonwealth appearance. You mm-hmm. were on Team Cayman 2014 when the games were held in Glasgow.
Correct.
Talk to us about, in your opinion, what has changed, the level of growth in 10 years. Obviously, you've matured as a person mm-hmm. in 10 years, but I suspect that too has also happened as an athlete.
Oh, most definitely. Yeah, so I believe I was one of the youngest competitors, definitely in the squash, but generally in the Commonwealth Games back then in 2014. So I went there, and for me, it was almost as if I was a fan that was getting to play with all of my idols. You know, I didn't really, as much as I took it seriously as an experience to better myself for my career going forward, because I did see the potential for me to compete at a very high level at these tournaments. When I was that age, I was more idolizing people, and I was really taking it in, and I was almost more of an observer that was competing, and I didn't really have much, or at least put much pressure on myself to compete that well. But I mean, obviously, I've always, I think the strongest aspect of my game is heart. So like, even though I was playing against the number 20 in the world, I was trying to win. But I was 15, and I was honestly like, every shot that he hit, that was an amazing shot. I was like, You know, I was just idolizing these guys, and you know, getting to sit down at the same cafeteria as like world number one people that I know everything about their life and I've never met them. And yeah, so that's what that experience was like for me back in 2014. But what has changed, obviously, as you said, is that I've matured physically. I've matured. I have a lot more squash experience under my belt, having played university squash and played for the national team at a senior level now as well. My fitness level is a lot higher than it was when I was that age, because I take my fitness a lot more seriously. But generally that aspect and that dynamic of feeling like an actual competitor at these games, like I had that pressure on myself because I know I put in a certain amount of work and I have expectations of myself and I feel the pressure to do well for my country. Whereas when I was a lot younger, I didn't feel as much of that pressure. And so it feels really good that I was able to take that pressure. And as you said earlier, all the athletes look composed. I feel as though we were very composed, Cameron and I felt as though we had a mission and we knew what we needed to do. And we saw everybody as somebody that was in our way and we just needed to dispatch them. So it was a completely different dynamic between the last games and this game.
Indeed. Now you mentioned Cameron, and the event that you participated in was the doubles squash competition. So, mm-hmm. You weren't the only athlete in the, I wouldn't call it a ring, it's the court.
The court.
Thank you very much. The court. You lost the first round, but you and your partner dominated the rounds thereafter, leading up to the finals against Barbados, mm-hmm. Which you recorded a stunning victory. You both became the first Cayman Islands squash players to return gold to the Cayman Islands. That's got to be an immense moment of pride for you. You're now inked permanently in the sports history books of the Cayman Islands. Yeah. What does that feel like? I mean, you're kind of like a superhero here, and you talked about, idolizing, the senior players in 2014 when you were 15. Today, there's a 15-year-old in high school. There's a 14-year-old coming out to the squash club seeing you, practice, play, and teach, and you are there, ooh, and ah, and yeah. Wow, I want to be just like him. What does that feel like?
I mean, even when you say it there, I get a little bit of butterflies in my stomach, to be honest. It's a surreal feeling. And like I said just now, like when we were on court, like we just had such a straight line mission in our heads, me and Cameron, or Cameron and I. And so even hearing that this was a historic win was like news to me. It was just because I was just so tunnel vision into winning each individual match. So it feels so good that like I was so plugged in, and then finally the tournament is over. You've won. Here these accolades, this amazing thing that has happened. And so it's like I now finally get the moment to like really rest and sit in it. And like I say, it's surreal, honestly. I feel so privileged to have been able to do it for Cayman. Cayman is a country I love. Like I wear our colors with so much pride. So to just be able to give anything back to Cayman is just like, it makes my hands shake, I love my country. So I love that I've been able to give something back to the country, and it's something that everybody can wear with pride going forward. And hopefully, it gives squash more weight and conversations as to resources and just to keep the sport growing. Cause like, anybody that plays squash in Cayman, I feel they love the sport, and anybody that's involved in it wants it to grow because it's such an amazing sport. It's such a great avenue to network and to express yourself. I feel like it's such an expressive outlet as far as sports go. Some sports you have a very specific role, but in squash I feel like anybody can have superpowers in their own right. They can utilize whatever attributes they've been given and become an amazing squash player. So I think it's such an amazing sport. So I feel so proud and privileged that I was able to achieve something within it, and I hope that it just means more growth for Cayman.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
and also to following on from that, a chef's mission, looking on and being involved in various sports, it's great to see Cayman striving in a number of sports. Traditionally, years ago, it was just all about athletics. Mm-hmm. Now you're seeing, gymnastics coming up, you're seeing squash, the non-traditional sports, yes. And I feel...
Swimming.
Swimming, but, swimming has always been there in terms of being in the Commonwealth and also in the Olympics.
Right?
But we've had some amazing athletes over the years, the Frasers, etc. But now you're seeing the other sports, coming through. And also for Cayman, in terms of, that whole recognition as a force to be reckoned with.
Yes.
I feel as if we're now sort of punching through that glass ceiling to say, we are here. You will feel our presence when we step out there in the field of play. And for that, it basically is a testament to how much, you know, we have put into sports over the years, and to our government in supporting the respective sporting organization over the years. So we're now seeing the result of that sort of a development for Cayman. And I think in the future we will continue to improve, and we're going to start seeing some more medals.
All right, well, yeah. I think we're all very excited about that as well. And as you talk about the pride in the Cayman Islands, I too find myself getting some goosebumps in the process.
Oh, awesome.
Now, whilst you brought back Julian together with Cameron Stafford, the gold plate for the Cayman Islands, you performed in other singles events. As a matter of fact, your performance throughout Birmingham 2022 really stood out. You won 4 out of 6 matches. Obviously, your level of play and your performance have improved significantly in the past 10 years, from 2014 to 2022. What important lesson, and if you can, is there a single important lesson that stands out above the rest that you've learned about your game, your commitment to that game, obviously your commitment to fitness and performance, but also playing at that level that you've learned throughout this experience?
Yeah, most definitely. I've actually had a bit of time to think about this. And what I would say, if I could bring it down to one singular lesson, it has to be a bit of an umbrella word, and I'll elaborate on it, is just the ability to apply oneself. I really feel as though like squash is a special sport in that, like I said, there's not one particular body type that is good at it. Anybody can have superpowers in their own right based on their attributes that they're God-given. And I've seen, like, since 2014, for example, the two guys that were in the final of the men's singles this year were Joel Macon and Paul Cole. In 2014, when I went to the Commonwealth Games, I'd never heard of Joel Macon, and Paul Cole was, I think, number 80 in the world, not really blessed with any sort of racket skills, just a fitness freak, right? And to see 8 years on that those guys are now in the final and the two best players outright in the Commonwealth Games is, like, so inspirational to me. And I feel as though, so just a little bit of squash background in terms of, like, the Pro Tour, maybe in the last 10 years, like, the last 10 years, so 10 years ago, I'd say the game was more centered around who is the most skillful player, which will usually stem from, you know, having a really good background in the sport from a young age, being around really high level pros from a young age. And basically, who was going to be number one in the world is slated from a very young age. You knew who was going to be the next number one in the world. Whereas now you have people like Paul Cole, who's been around for a while, and he's just made it to world number one last year. And he's somebody that, I think in his last year of World Juniors, he only made it to the second round. The guy that's number two in the world behind him won it and didn't even know who Paul Cole was.
Wow.
But it's just that ability that Paul Cole has had throughout his entire career to just continue to apply himself. And you can see it in his game. Every single year, he's improved tremendously. And it's been through simple incremental improvements that he's been trying to make to his game. And now he's just gotten to this point where he's climbed to the top of Mount Olympus. And it's just through constant application of himself and just belief in himself. And the same thing can go for Joel Macon, who has a similar story and is just maybe just like a step down in terms of success as of right now, but he's also quite young. So it's players like those that give me the most inspiration, because their stories are achievable.
Yes.
And it's because it's just them. They don't have any sort of big name coach or anything with them. A lot of the times it's just them that train themselves. They don't even have a coach.
Right.
And it's just their ability to just wake up every morning. For example, let's say they say, I'm going to take a 2 mile run every morning, right? Even though, like, one time to do 2 miles might not be that hard, but to wake up every single day, and some days you feel monkey, some days you don't want to do it. Just that sort of determination and drive. So if you have the ability to apply yourself and you have that confidence in yourself, the world can be yours and you can achieve whatever you want to achieve, I really believe. Because those guys, to me, are some of the best athletes in the world. And I think anybody can look up to the determination and application that they put into their sport. And I think that transcends into anything in life.
Absolutely. Yeah, fantastic insight and good advice.
Yeah, thank you.
And I mean, the message to our youngsters, you may go to a competition and you may come last or in the middle of the pack, but you don't give up or stop competing. you just keep working. You have a goal. You want to be number one day. So therefore, you continue to work, you apply yourself, and you may just reach that. So therefore, like Julian has explained, I mean, those guys, when they competed in 2014, they were not number one, right?
Right.
But they continued, and therefore put in the time, and look at where they are today.
Mm-hmm.
So the message is just don't give up. If you have a goal, apply yourself and work towards it.
Absolutely. Again, very, very good advice. Yes. Now, there is a bit of a difference between a gold plate and a gold medal. And we want to be able to give our audiences, you know, the benefit of understanding the difference, if you will, in the nomenclatures. The Cayman Islands in the doubles tournament returned a gold plate for squash, making it both Julian and Cameron the first Cayman Islands squash players to return gold to the Cayman Islands at a Commonwealth Games. But it's not a gold medal as you would see standing on the podium, you know, first, second, and third place, gold, silver, and bronze. Maybe you can explain to our audiences that difference, Janet.
Yeah, in the context of squash, you know, we have a draw, and everyone is entered in the draw. So that is the main draw. So therefore, the winners of the main draw will get, you know, the gold medal, and that counts towards the overall medal for the country. But the governing body is, you know, the World Squash Body. You know, they want to recognize also the achievement of the other countries and athletes that have competed. So therefore, they have more or less the consolation or the plate draw. If you've lost your first match, then all the players or the countries fall into that group, and then you compete then for that plate. So therefore, it's a testament to your achievement in terms of you have then competed against all those other countries, and now you have then won the plate. So therefore, your hard work isn't in vain in terms of, you know, you train 2-3 years before a competition, you go there, you lose your first match, and it's like, oh my gosh, one match and I'm out of it.
Right.
You still have that other chance to also to prove yourself, and also to see where the country falls in the overall scheme of the pack. You may have 20 countries competing, but, you know, only one can get the main draw in terms of a medal. You know, all the other first round losers from, you know, the main draw, you're also competing against each other to see who will then rise to the top
right.
of that group. So you may be competing against another, say, 15 countries. And so therefore, you know, winning that is also a testament of your achievement in terms of, so now when you look at the overall scheme of all the countries, you're basically falling out in the middle of that pack.
Okay.
And therefore you can punch through that and hopefully get a better seed the next competition where you're not coming up against, say, the top 5 seeds of the tournament that will then hit you out into the next round.
All right. Well, again, gold is gold in my book. It's the first ever for squash, so I'm going to take it, and it's just as meaningful, if not more so, than any of the other awards. You will win in the future.
Oh, thank you.
Looking at some of the factors off the court, your doubles partner, Cameron Stafford, comes from a squash dynasty of a family. You know, known for many things, but certainly the ever crowd-pleasing trick shots that we saw during your matches, particularly against Barbados, which certainly gets the crowd involved. But how involved is your own family, Julian, in your squash challenges and successes?
Oh, as I said before, my family are the best support system I could have ever asked for. Before I get into that, before I dive too deep into that, I just want to big up my Cameron Stafford, my doubles partner. That man is, I've said it before and I mean it every time I say it, I believe that Cayman has produced something special in the form of Cameron Stafford. I genuinely think that Cameron is a generational talent in squash.
Yeah.
I think that some of the things that man can do with a racket are obscene, and there are maybe only 10 people I think in the world that can do some of the things that I've seen Cameron create on a squash court. So I just want to send a big out to Cameron, show him some love. That's my guy. I've known him for forever, and I'm so happy that him and I have been able to do this together. But yeah, my family, since the inception of my squash career, have been the driving force behind me playing squash. Mm-hmm. I mean, as a child, as a young child, before I even started taking squash seriously, my family thought it would be important for me to be in some form of sport and to be like competitive in some form of sport, because they believe that it gives young children that drive, and I completely agree. It gives them that drive and competitive edge that you need in all aspects of life. So my family had me involved in sport from a young age, but my father and his brother, my uncle Jody and my father Jules Jervis, they were some of the first young junior members of the squash club when it was first built, and they lived right down at Tropical Garden, so it was just a bike ride away. So from a young age, those guys are playing squash, and not to a regional or national level, but competitively amongst their fellows. And you know, to this day, I still see those guys coming out to play against each other. And right. As a kid, that energy that those guys brought, that competitive energy around just playing against each other, not necessarily to any high level. They'll probably laugh when they hear this later, but not to any high level.
Not like you and Kevin. Right. A different kind of level. Old guys.
They might dispute it, but yeah, not playing Danny's very high level, but just like the level of contention between them was something that I just loved being there for, you know, a little bit of banter. And like that got me so pumped to be playing the sport, just so I could get involved in a little bit of banter with them. And as soon as they saw me play, they were like, yeah, this is the one for him. And I think it was my Uncle Jody that got me my first lesson actually at the club. And maybe after three lessons, that first coach called my Uncle Jody and told him to come right down to the club. He needed to see this. And apparently, you know, that day my coach told him that I was a natural. And so that's just an example of some of the influence my family's had. Of course, my mom and my dad, they've been to almost every single squash tournament I've ever played internationally, which is like, it's just amazing. It feels as though I have my home base right there with me at every tournament. They're always the loudest people in the crowd. It's actually become a bit of a tradition. Every single time that we go to an international tournament, my family come up with some new ridiculous cheer that radiates throughout the entire tournament. And by the end of the tournament, everybody is saying the same cheer
as us.
So it's it's like a big confidence booster, and it gives me so much comfort when I go to a tournament. Sometimes it's a bit overwhelming. Sometimes I'm a bit intimidated, but my family have this ever constant confidence about me, even if it's a little bit ignorant sometimes. Like, you know, I'm playing world number one tomorrow, they're like, Julian, you took 6 points off of world number 24, you tell me you can't beat that man?
that's a very good point.
So even though, you know, in my head I'm thinking, all right, daddy, you know, but like that, like having that around me all the time, I can't take it for granted. It's
supposed to reinforce that.
It is a very large part of why I compete, and why I compete to the level that I have been able to compete. So I definitely can't have done it without them.
That's fantastic. That truly is fantastic. I'm very glad, very heartwarming to hear that connection still exists and has existed throughout your career.
Most definitely.
Finally, what's next for Julian Jervis, and certainly for squash and or Team Cayman?
Yeah, I'll go first. So for the rest of the year, we've had quite a jam-packed year with competition, relatively speaking, to the last 3 years. However, next year is going to be even more jam-packed than this year has been, which is absolutely it's so exciting. It's an amazing thing. From now until the end of the year is a bit of a tapering off period. You know, we'll be training. We'll be commencing our serious training going into those tournaments soon, but we are just coming back from Senior Castle now, so the next couple of weeks will probably be a little bit watered down in the training aspect. I'll probably be diving deeper into my coaching. Me, Cameron, and Coach Sardar, our national coach, we're all working together with all of the juniors. I think we'll be putting a lot of emphasis and a lot of energy into the junior programs going forward for now, trying to boost up, you know, the rapport with the kids and just get a lot more kids playing to a higher level. And when you get those kids playing to a level where they can compete with each other without a coach, without needing the facilitation of a coach, it's self-sustaining. You know, it becomes circular because they want to come down there. You see more kids down there just like challenging their little buddies, and in the summers you see kids down there 3-4 hours a day and you have to shoo them out of the club. So I'm trying to get, I definitely, like, that's the goal from now until whenever we recommence our serious training for the next couple of tournaments.
All right, fantastic. Yeah. And Team Cayman, I mean, I know you had the Commonwealth Games, but you were also off to another event,
yes.
You know, shortly thereafter. So it seems like your schedule is also very hectic.
I think I use most of my vacation each year for sports.
I imagine.
My father was like, Jan, when are you going to have vacation? I was like, that was vacation. But anyhow, Team Cayman for squash, we competed earlier this year in a qualifying event for the CAC Games in Guatemala. So therefore, the team has qualified for the Central American Caribbean Games, which will be held in the July-August timeframe.
Okay.
And also next year, we also have a qualifying event, which will be Cartagena, Colombia, which is for the qualifying event to be able to compete in the Pan Am Games, which will be held in November, and the qualifier in May. And in addition to that, we also have the Caribbean Championships and the FBS Championships. So next year is going to be a jam-packed year for squash in terms of competition, not only for our senior team, but also for our junior team as well.
All right. Yeah. Well, I want to thank you both for being our guests. I want to congratulate you again on behalf of all of your countrymen and women on your phenomenal success, yourself, of course, and Cameron Stafford for certainly, again, historical performances and wishing you all the very best for the future, some of the games and tournaments that you will be facing the remainder of this year and into next year. I want to give each of you an opportunity for some closing comments, if you wish, at this time.
Sure. I'll just go further just to thank Janet once again. I really feel as though she is the workhorse of all, like, she does all of the things behind the scenes, and I don't even think she gets enough recognition sometimes for just the tremendous amount of work that she does for us. Really and truly, none of this stuff can happen without her. So just publicly, I'd like to thank you again, Janet. Yeah, really a tremendous woman, and Cayman, really, like, she's a gem of the Cayman Islands. And then also just like to thank anybody and everybody that has supported us and to continue supporting us and to get more people playing squash. Everybody needs to go play some squash because it's an amazing sport and it breeds amazing opportunities.
Indeed. Well, thank you, Julian, thank you. Gentleman and a scholar.
Thank you.
And for me, I'd just like to, you know, thank our athletes. They're a great bunch of guys to work with, and also to the government who has supported us and made squash one of the focus sports. And has afforded us the opportunity to be able to hire a national coach, and also to the Olympic Committee also for their assistance in terms of funding for the various qualifying event and the major games out there. So, you know, just thank them as well, our volunteers and our board members who are there and in full support of our national program that's out there. And thank you for inviting us on here.
Of course,
to discuss.
So a real pleasure, and again, I thank you very much for being fantastic guests, and we look forward to following your career much more closely, and certainly, of course, that of Team Cayman. And to our guests, we thank you for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed today's episode as much as we did. Please remember to tune in for our second episode here on Let's Talk, exploring the issues affecting all of our lives. I'm your host, Austin Harris. Until next time.